بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على نبينا الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، إن شاء الله today we'll get into a new ideology which Ibn al-Jawzi rahmatullah alayh discusses and debunks. And I personally believe that this ideology is very, very relevant to our times. And I previously believed and thought that this ideology is really the result of the great advancements humanity has made in our recent times in terms of scientific inquiry and studies and advancements. And this ideology is simply a symptom or a side effect of these advancements. However, looking at what Ibn al-Jawzi rahmatullah alayh is discussing here, it turns out that this ideology has been around for quite a while now. And this is the ideology of naturalism. Naturalism is a belief or a notion that the forces of nature come from within and thus excludes any spiritual or supernatural explanation to the natural world. So in Arabic, this is called al-tabai'iyyin, from the word tabi'a, which means nature, and in English it's naturalism. Again, this is a notion that nature functions due to forces within nature itself. So, for example, when you look at a cloud, naturalism explains that cloud as being its own independent force. Why is there a cloud? Because that cloud somehow formulated itself. And essentially, the roots of this ideology in terms of our modern context goes back to the Enlightenment movement of Europe about 500 years ago with this notion that's called disenchantment. Disenchantment essentially was the Enlightenment movement's effort of dealing with superficial beliefs that they thought were hindering human progression in Europe. In other words, people were so obsessed with superficial understandings, these superstitions as we call them, that they could not see beyond their superstition to unlock the scientific keys of the natural world. So in order to get out of that, they completely disenchanted the world to where nature is nothing more than a series of causes and effects that are a result of forces within those causes and within those effects. And thus, a higher being, and to us Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has no role to play in terms of the events of nature on earth. So when we read verses like وَهُوَ الَّذِي يُرْسِلُ الرِّيَاحَ بُشْرًا بَيْنَ يَدَيْ رَحْمَتِهِ, Allah is the one who sends the wind before, as a glad tidings before His mercy comes. Allah here is describing the cycle of water. Wind comes, and wind travels faster, I guess, than clouds. And it is what is clouds that push, the wind that pushes the clouds, and those clouds contain rain, and then the clouds release its rain in order for agriculture and harvest to come about. What Allah is doing in this verse is He is inserting Himself in all of this process, saying He is the one who causes the wind to flow and to blow, thus causing the clouds to come, and He is the one who sends down His mercy. Right? He words it as His mercy. He's referring to rain here to show you that the Quran, not only in this place but in other verses, uses the word mercy synonymous to rain, as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that His presence is in that rain, not His physical presence, but His names and attributes are in this rain. Rain is His mercy. And Allah does this with other parts of nature. He is the one who created day and night. He is the one who created the mountains. He is the one who causes everything to occur. What's called causality. Allah always inserts Himself here. But what the Enlightenment movement did through this process of disenchanting is essentially exclude Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all of this. And as a result, what we find today is that it is very difficult for people to engage Allah. Why? Because there's this barrier that has been placed and propped up between us and the primary means, or one of the primary means of getting to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and feeling His presence, and that is nature. And I thought that this is a huge problem that needs a lot of research and a lot of discussion, a lot of debate in order to get around. And let us be honest with ourselves. Our approach to understanding the world, our perception of the world, is heavily, if not exclusively, influenced by scientific inquiry. That what that means is we only understand the world in accordance to science. What does the mountain represent? What does it mean? It means that two plate tectonics hit each other, collided, and a mountain came about. That's what a mountain signifies. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. But the way the Quran portrays it is very different. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that that mountain is a symbol of who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, His names and His attributes. That mountain, Allah caused it to come about. It's not simply two plate tectonics. That is the means by which Allah caused it to come about. But it is Allah who moved those two plate tectonics at a particular time. Right? So how can we get over this huge challenge of ours? Ibn al-Jawzi makes it very simple for us. Very simple for us. And he says the following. It is completely and simply irrational to consider that nature has forces, or the forces of nature come from within the elements of nature. It is impossible. How so? Because if, for example, you were to take water, and water is part of nature. Now, according to chemistry, water is H2O, two atoms of hydrogen and one of oxygen. Now, imagine taking that water and placing it in a sealed container, and everything besides the H2O is removed from that container. It's literally nothing except the H2O. And you were to leave it there for 1,000 years. Theoretically speaking, and assuming that nothing is able to make its way into this container, and that for the entire 1,000 years, it is exclusively H2O, that's it. What can we assume is going to happen to that water after 1,000 years? Theoretically speaking, nothing is going to happen. It's not going to move. It's not going to change. It's not going to evolve. It's not going to be different. It's going to be exactly the same as it was when it was put in 1,000 years prior to that. Why is that? What does that mean? In order for water to change, or any element of nature to change from its original state, right, it requires an external force. So if water were to be converted into energy, there's some sort of chemical process that splits these atoms, changes it, converts it, whatever it is, right? But the idea is that there's something external that interacts with water that causes this result. And essentially what this means is that water in of itself has no consciousness, has no capability, has no power, has no ability to choose. And thus, any change that occurs on water or any elements of nature is the result of an external force causing that to happen. Now, for Islam and for Muslims, for believers, the external force is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who's causing the external force to occur. And therefore, any element of nature is completely powerless, incapable of changing or moving or functioning independent of external forces, right? That is one way to see it. Another way to see it is that there's simply too much consistency in nature for it to be result of simple causes and effects. There has to be some organization, right? So for example, if a farmer is plowing his land, and he takes his seeds and starts putting it in this land and he covers it with dirt. Does the farmer need to be precise in the position of that seed when it's put into the dirt? Meaning, is there a certain face up way of the dirt, of the seed? Now, is there something on the seed that says this way should be facing up in order for the plant to come about? Not at all. The farmer puts his seeds in this dirt regardless of how they are put in. The flower or the plant itself will always go towards the elevated side. It'll always go outside of the dirt towards the sun, whereas the roots will always go inward down. We never find a scenario where the roots are coming up and the plant itself is going down. Never. Yet there seems to be no process, right? Likewise, the consistency of atoms. When you look at atoms, you find that there's simply too much consistency, too much precision and perfection for it to be the results of randomness, simply causes and effects, independent of an organizer of all of these things. So for example, if someone were to say, I have a tree that produces apples, and it produces apples that are always of the same mass. Every time apples grow, every single apple is of the same mass. We would say that is impossible. Yet when you look at atoms, atoms are always of the same mass, protons and electrons, that have the same amount of force that keeps those atoms in balance. Slight variations in those would cause the atom to fall apart. And if the universe is created in atoms, right? And if an atom were to fall apart, literally the entire universe, if the atom system were to fall apart, then literally the entire universe will fall apart. There is simply too much precision for it to be the result of inward forces. It must be the result of an external force, and that force is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.